Oh, she see my mentions. It's a fucking nightmare. Never argued with so many ignorant people in one day. What up, Bobby? Jack alerted, how you doing? Bobby, appreciate you. Steph, how are you? I'm good. Hanging in there. Still don't have a real copy. If y'all keep thinking one week I'm going to show up and have the actual book, it's not going to happen. We will only read the advanced copy. J.R. Smith whooped that fool's ass. Whooped that fool's ass. Man. Give you all a couple more minutes. Nickel Moore, that's not helpful. My mom has real copies in every bathroom in her house. It's not helpful either. Don't send me a real copy. I don't want a real I could get a real copy if I needed one. Please don't. I'm serious. Don't. Not like a joke. Don't. Like, don't. Don't. Oh man, pupfish, shut the fuck up. What's up, Jay Dappa? Jordan, how goes it? I bathed both my dogs today. Behold their cleanliness. Behold their cleanliness. In fact, you know what? I'll sit over here. I'm just gonna... Alright, how about that? So we can at least see something that's not me. He's nodding off. What's up, P-Pup? Dude, what? I'm not gonna take off my shirt. Every night with you. All right, let's fucking do this so I can play some video games. First and foremost, if you are here and you planned on hearing some words from me about the situation taking place across our country right now, I have said everything I needed and have to say today on Twitter, which you can see very clearly at twitter.com/WRBolin, whether you're on Twitter or not. So if you're looking for my thoughts on that, go there. I also said some words on Patreon on Friday that I'm basically going to be addressing again tomorrow, on tomorrow's episode of RBP. I will be speaking to it as well. And it's something that we're going to be speaking about for the foreseeable future in some degree. So, that being said, in the last two nights, we have raised $3,000 for two separate causes that I want to continue to direct people towards. The first of which was the Black Visions Collective in Minnesota. On Friday, we raised $2,000. Which I sent to them this morning, and you can contribute to them directly at blackvisionsmn.org. And then, yesterday, I was actually looking for a cause in Houston to support, and I tweeted about one that I had found, and basically, long story short, Brad Scarface Jordan called my phone, the phone I'm holding in my hand, rang and said Brad Jordan on it, and I was like, what? Anyway, he put me on. He has an organization in Houston that he is the chairman of, and he put me on to their, he put me on a three-way call with their CEO to break down for me exactly what they're doing, and you can read all about that on their website, which I am pulling up for you currently. It's also in the fucking title of the stream. Un momento. Good God. I have said a lot today. Where is it? Ah! PositivePurposes.org. It's the Positive Purposes movement that they founded in Houston. And again, just go to their, if you're like, what do? Go to their About section. It'll tell you. All right, now, chapter 4 of Total Frat Move, which, by the way, ironically, trigger warning, ends with like a one of these college students believing that he has seen a police brutality. Ironically, he's very drunk and it is not the case. Trigger warning. I've said it. The final night of freedom. Wait. Yep. Nope. This is the correct chapter. Ron. Also join our Discord. Thank you, Bobby, for throwing the link in there. Wait, but we're not donating tonight, though, just to be clear. Nightbot. That was yesterday. But that is the link. It's just the optics. It's just the optics. All right. The final night of free... Stop fucking talking and distracting me. I'm reading this fucker a bedtime story. Oh yeah, and we sent $1,000 to the Positive Purpose Movement. Anyway, final night of freedom. I gasped for clean air, and remember last night, last Sunday, they were getting hazed. I gasped for clean air as Atwater ushered us out of the musty basement like traumatized cattle. Mr. Weston's voice was still echoing violently through my head as I tried to make sense of what was happening. The sort of confusion that can only be created by the perfect mindfuck was still visible on many of my Pledge Brothers' faces. The expression on mine was similar to that of an escaped mental patient getting a blowjob during a root canal. I was relieved that I had gotten my bid, horrified that Mr. Weston existed, pumped about the party, and dreading the beginning of pledgeship the next day. So yeah, they're gonna have a party or whatever. Yeah. What's up, everybody? By the way, hi. Hope this brings you some levity. The actives had reassumed control of the porch, and there was no fucking way I was gonna be the first moron to stroll up and pretend we were all best friends again. So I stood my ground and waited to see how everything played out. But nobody else made a move. Why the fuck are you just standing there? Asked Atwater, pointing to the stairs. Go! Party! Is Mr. Weston up there? Asked Tim. No, you won't see him for the rest of the night. Tim turned around and bounded up the stairs with his bottle of champagne. I took a swig to get the taste of the basement out of my mouth and followed him. We were greeted by a mob of actives, and the crowd immediately swallowed Tim. David Young, one of the seniors I had met at a dinner, put his arm around me and pulled me in. Y'all are solid, he hiccuped. Solid pledge class. It'll do just fine. Then he let go and turned back for the next guy, breath reeking of Budweiser and chewing tobacco, and I heard him say the exact same thing verbatim. With every step, I was stopped and given more words of approval and congratulations. When I finally got through the welcome committee, I turned to find Monty and noticed a pack of Jeeps, Tahoes, and trucks parking in the street. Sorority girls were jumping out, screaming and hugging. It had been a full week since the ones going through Rush had hung out with us because of their sorority silence, where freshmen weren't allowed to talk to guys or drink as part of their recruitment process. Thank you. What was happening? Oh. The yard filled up as more and more of them arrived, and then they made their way toward the house. They were all wearing tank tops with their letters shaped by rhinestones, along with neon face paint and temporary tattoos. Monty walked up and nodded to me. Thank God, he said, looking at the girls. I was really starting to miss them. We clinked our bottles together, and I sloshed back the little champagne I had left and hurled the empty bottle at the roof of the Sigma house next door. While I watched it sail through the air, I felt the back of my shirt tighten and a hand grip on my shoulder. What the fuck are you doing, Pledge? I turned around to face a pair of bushy eyebrows on a head covered in shaggy brown hair belonging to a guy wearing an untucked dark green polo and a look of disgust. I struggled to get my words out. I was just, is that how you talk to an active? Why the fuck do you want to be in this fraternity? Who are you? Why do you deserve to be my brother? Why are you even here? He was in attack mode, rattling off rhetorical questions in an angry tirade. Any response would have just fueled the flame, so I decided to maintain eye contact. Looking intimidated was the safest play. What are you, fucking stupid or something? He continued. Atwater slid out from between two girls and grabbed him. God damn it, Jackson, you fucking jackass. Save it for tomorrow. What's the big deal? Jackson smiled at him. I was just having a little fun with the kid. He smirked at me and chugged his beer as he turned away. Ignore that, said Atwater as we both watched Jackson push past Trindle. Did you see how many fucking girls I just got for you? Yeah, I saw an army of them pull up. I'm assuming sorority silence is over? You're damn right. Get in there and make me proud. He turned to help two actives carrying a Gatorade water cooler. Pink liquid sloshed out as they set it down on a bench, and Scott McCandles threw a bag of 250 red solo cups down next to it. McCandles is the guy that wears the kilt, I think. Atwater grabbed a cup and threw it to me. Might as well, he said. I headed for the cooler, and Monty trailed me, trying to reason with me as I filled my first cup. Whoa, do you really want to end up like Tim after paint your toga? That shit is lethal. I nodded and gulped down the pink mixture. I don't give a shit, dude. I'm getting David Hasselhoff drunk tonight. The rest of our play... That's so depressing. The rest of our play that's like a... That he ended up with that as a label. From that drunk burger video, man. Did he win? John? Need an update. Doug's update, please. Doug's update, please. Thank you, Drac. Thank you, Bruce, for being here. Support, moral support. Do you have any idea how much time I've spent alone in this house with these dogs in the past, since October? Do you have any idea? That I have any sanity left in my brain is a miracle of God. A miracle. All right. Oh, this is gonna get weird. This chapter's fucking weird, man. This book is fucking weird. This whole experience is weird. My life is weird. So weird. What? Oh, yeah, so he's drinking the punch like a dumbass. Stupid fucking move. Never drink the punch. Male, female, don't drink the punch. Doesn't matter. The punch is bad, okay? That's end of the fucking story.
But not this one. I nodded and gulped down the pill. Oh, he's getting David Hasselhoff drunk. The rest of our Pledge Brothers worked their way through the gauntlet, and the actives faded into the house after growing tired of congratulations. Trindle bounced in and out of the groups, redirecting each conversation to Mr. Weston in a lowered voice until he was shooed away by those who were trying to stay positive and hit on girls. I was waiting in line for the cooler, and well on my way to brutally murdering all of my brain cells when I heard a familiar voice. Isn't that punch supposed to be, like, for girls? It was Allison. I can't remember the voices I do week to week, so I give up. I hadn't seen her since the incident with the cannon. Which girl is the deep voice? Just somebody tell me that. Which girl's the deep voice girl? I'm going to do deep voices for all of them if I don't find out which one. Is it her? Is it Allison? Okay, we'll go with Allison. Allison's about to get weird. Okay.
Isn't that punch supposed to be for girls?
It was Allison. I hadn't seen her since the incident with the cannon. Well, girls and real degenerates who like blacking out immediately. She went in for a hug, but the punch had already begun to grab hold of my conscience, so I went in for an early, probably inappropriate makeout. She turned her head and giggled.
Oh no, sweetheart, she smirked. We had fun, but I'm a little too old for you, and you're a little too crazy for me. You need a girl in your age group.
She grabbed a shorter girl with long blonde hair by the shoulder and turned her toward me. This is Amy. She's one of our new girls. What a fucking world. I immediately refocused my efforts. Amy, I'm Towns. Nice to meet you. She smiled and rocked her shoulders back and forth. The fuck? You want some punch? I offered like a true gentleman. Sure, she said. We're celebrating, aren't we? I'll leave you...
I'll leave you two to talk,
Allison said, and winked at me before walking away. Oh, fucking shit, man. Oh, God. Oh, God. I gotta stop smoking before we do this. Maintain composure. For the next 30 minutes, Amy schooled me on sorority recruitment and how excited she was while I tried to inappropriately divide my attention between her and getting dumbface wasted. The difference between sorority and fraternity bid day became clear immediately. Oh, my God. I, like, absolutely love my new sisters. They are all so gorgeous and sweet. Definitely, I smiled. Congratulations. I mean, like, being a pie, it's the best thing that's ever happened to me, you know? Like, they just keep giving us presents. You must be so excited to be an alpha. Did you get any presents?
Not yet. How many girls are in your pledge class?
Like, 63 of the absolute prettiest, most gorgeous girls ever. I mean, obviously, some of them are going to go, like, to other houses, too. But at least, like, 20 of us will be here all night.
The actives were keeping to themselves inside with the older girls while we mingled with the new members of various sororities on the porch. Monty returned, and I introduced him to Amy. Then she took us around and introduced us to some of her pledge sisters, all of whom were total fucking smoke shows.
More and more girls kept arriving, and the ratio became increasingly favorable. There were 42 of us and twice as many of them. After discussing the football schedule with the girls, I was 9 cups of punch deep. Jesus fucking God. 9?
Ross. Why? Why?
What? 9 cups of punch deep, well on my way to blacking out, and smiling like a circus clown. I don't know what a circus clown smells like. Smiling like a circus clown with red stains on and around my lips. The sound system on the back, I'm sure it was tempting to make some type of fucked up period joke there, and I'm really glad I didn't. See? More mature than you would think. There was a lot of instances where I could have made this book much worse than it actually is. So you're welcome. Mom. And mostly Mom. Mom, you're welcome. If you're listening, I'm also sorry. The sound system on the back deck was playing country classics as my new Pledge Brothers and I started belligerently bonding arm in arm with some of the pie girls, singing along to Friends in Low Places. The actives weren't fucking with us. Mr. Weston was nowhere to be seen, and I didn't have a worry in the world.
Oh man, I bet that changes.
As the song ended, 5 older girls came skipping from inside, wielding handles of Taka vodka, which is the equivalent of bottled homeless urine. They worked their way through a group of us, pulling heads back and dumping vodka down unsuspecting throats. Tim walked up with his arm around a redhead. He leaned in toward me, attempting to be discreet. I'm taking her to do some X in the bathroom. He laughed, but I knew he wasn't kidding. Seriously? Now? I asked. You want in?
One of the taco girls walked up and gave me the tilt-your-head-back look that I had become familiar with. I took a mouthful and swallowed as fast as I could before answering Tim. I'm good with this shit, but thanks.
Your loss, pussy.
He stumbled off with the ginger.
Jesus.
Oh, shit is hitting the fan in Austin as we speak. Ginger. Where was the ginger? Shouts to gingers. Respect to gingers. Love gingers. Huge fan of gingers. Love them. Let's see. What are they doing? That sounded like Trump campaigning and talking about how black people love him. I love the blacks. The blacks love me. I'm sorry. I couldn't help myself. He stumbled off with a ginger. What are they doing? Asked Amy, who clearly half heard our conversation. That's my pledge sister, Whitney. Nothing, nothing. She has to pee. He's taking her to the bathroom. Nice. Amy was telling me about how she did cheer in high school and considered doing the same thing in college when Atwater walked out with his eyes completely glazed over.
Inside to fuck shit up, he yelled. Everybody in!
I wasn't exactly jumping at the chance to rejoin the actives, but Amy grabbed my hand and we headed for the door. On our way down the hallway toward the party, we passed Tim's redhead coming out of the bathroom. Tim emerged 30 seconds later, looking furtively to his left and right. Don't know what that word means. It's impossible that I could have possibly known what it meant then. I guarantee you I typed another word, highlighted it, hit synonyms, and then picked a cool one, and now we have furtively in a book that makes it sound like I'm smart when I'm not. That's how writing a book works. And cut to the front of the mob to find Whitney again. Or you know what's more likely? It was a word that I had already used really recently, and I was like, fuck! So I hit synonyms because I'm OCD about that. Furtively to my left and right, and cut to the front of the mob to find Whitney again. His left and right, not my left and right. Your friend is weird, Amy yelled over the music. He's a good guy, I assured her. He'll take good care of her. Towns is fucking full of shit. You don't even really know this cat, you know? Towns, you don't even really know this cat. Pulling since 2000, don't make me mute you. That's assault. I'm just kidding. When we made our way to the party room, I decided to switch to beer for safety's sake, and we headed for the tub with Amy attached to my hand. It was filled with ice and packed to the brim with Natty Light and Keystone. You want one? I asked Amy as I submerged my hand.
I'm fine with punch. Thanks, sweetie.
And then in italics it says, more for sweetie. Okay. Why is there just randomly a fucking inner dialogue? That's the only, like, maybe the only time in the book that happens. This might have been the chapter. I smoked weed and tried to write one chapter, and this might have been the one. That line makes me think this might have been the one. And then I remember I had to rewrite, like, most of that chapter because it was so fucking stupid because I just am an idiot. I cannot write stoned. Which is proof that I'm not high all the time, by the way, because I write like 20,000 fucking words a week now. So, I'm not sure who I'm trying to convince, me or you. More for sweetie, Jesus. I looked to the front of the room and saw a snowball of destruction beginning to form. The actives started flipping trash cans, throwing half-full beers at each other, and pouring entire cans onto each other's heads. A wooden chair flew across the room, through the air into the wall, breaking into pieces. I realized they were trashing the place now, because they had us to clean it all up for them. Even at our own midnight party, they were making sure we'd pay for it tomorrow. Amy headed in for the less destructive portion of the crowd as I cracked my beer, held it a foot above my face, and let it splash into my mouth. I lost sight of her when, if anyone says zillion beers in the chat, I'll rip your fucking head off. I lost sight of her when a roll of toilet paper flew over my head, unraveling onto my shoulder, and she mixed in with the hundreds of people dancing. As I made my way forward to find her, I spotted a shirtless Nate, ignoring song lyrics and screaming at the top of his lungs as if the apocalypse was imminent. Nate! I yelled to get his attention. He turned toward me, poured his beer onto my head, yelling the entire time, and ran off toward the tub for another. Is that the guy on ecstasy? It has to be. As liquid ran down my face, someone pushed me hard from behind and sent me stumbling forward. I turned around and faced Jackson. His shirt was ripped and his hair was soaked. He looked like a bad celebrity mugshot.
I fucking hate you, he said. This is the kind of shit that actors would say to me all the time when I was a pledge. They'd come up to me drunk and be like, I fucking hate you. And I'd just be like, great, dude. I'm so stoked to be here. Can't wait. Fuck. That was the best hazing. Just, I fucking hate you. I fucking hate everything about you. I'm looking at chat. Fine. Which one? Pick a dog. Both? Okay. Shit.
This is Bella. Oh, you can't see.
Son of a bitch.
Good dog. Yay. Okay. Everybody happy? Alright, we did it.
Okay. Yeah. All right, here's what we'll do. Here's what we'll do. Bruce, you want to say hi, buddy? Yeah. That's my boy.
You're my boy, Blue.
Peace. He wants nothing to do with this. Okay. He's like, y'all are a bunch of immature fucking idiots. And then he licks his own ass. What does that say about us? He fucking... Never mind. Focus, Ross. I fucking hate you. He said, letting out a breath-filled laugh, and then walked away shaking his head. Deep bass was pounding through the floor, freeing girls from their inhibitions with every beat. Jesus. They moved with the music in lines of three or four, spread throughout the dance floor. Some were facing each other and grinding, while others were ass to ass. While others were ass to ass? What? Fucking A. New York Times bestseller. Isn't that the stupidest thing you've ever heard? Unfucking real. Ass to ass, baby. Suddenly a random chick grabbed me by the arm and pulled me into her group. I had two girls behind me and two in the front, all holding drinks overhead, but none of them were Amy. Tim came out of nowhere with Whitney and attached himself to her backside, and they became the caboose to the slutty dancing train. The ex had obviously kicked in, and Tim was dancing with more ferocity than all the girls combined, aggressively attacking Whitney with his pelvis. She didn't even seem to notice, just danced with her eyes closed and smiled like she was the only one in the room. The song changed, and it triggered the girl in front of me to repeatedly drop her ass to the floor and then pop it back up, rubbing it into my crotch like she was trying to get me to pre-cum my fucking khakis. It took all my focus. God, I must have been horny as hell. It took all my focus not to pop a raging boner, and all I could do was stand there and drink while she made me into a human stripper pole. Tim was leaning back with his chin to his chest, staring shamelessly at Whitney's ass with both hands clenched high in the air like he'd just won gold at the Olympics. When the song ended, my crotch masseuse turned around and smiled at me. She was a solid five. She was a solid... What? Oh, man. She was a solid five. I bailed immediately toward the porch to try and find Amy. Jesus Christ, Towns. The party had... Towns is shallow, you see. He judges women only on their looks. Okay? He's not a perfect character. Crotch masseuse. Fucking... Somebody just said, oh, no. I think I can't. I don't know how far y'all are behind me. Oh yeah. So he bails from the five. Okay. Focus. Okay. The party had continued to grow while my dick was being assaulted, and the back porch was filled to the railing with people as well. I was getting to the point of absolute sloppiness, but this was my fucking midnight. It was supposed to be the drunkest night of my life, and I needed to step it up another notch. I spotted a few guys ripping cigs and decided that getting some nicotine in my blood might help. I walked up and asked one of my pledge brothers, Ryan Penny, if I could bum one.
"Yeah, no problem," he said. "You don't mind Marlboro Reds, do you?"
"No, I don't fucking mind, Penny. Do I look like a commie?" I took my first drag and tried to play it off when I immediately felt my knees go weak. Monty stumbled out of the house with Nate, smiling and holding the bottom of his shirt up as a basket to transport six beers. Nate, still shirtless and covered in sweat, pulled two from each of his pockets.
"We're shotgunning these fuckers," Tim ordered.
Penny grabbed a beer, pulled a knife from his boot, whipped it open, and stabbed a hole in the can in one fluid motion. Then he passed the knife to me, redneck shit, and around it went. Eight of us circled up, and Tim made a toast. "To this semester and our pledge class, I love you guys. And just remember, no matter what these insane bastards put us through over the next 12 weeks, we're going to come out alive on the other side and run this fucking campus." We all yelled in agreement and popped our cans. Monty finished first and dropped his can at his feet, letting the remaining foam run onto the deck.
"First, motherfuckers," he celebrated. "I'm going in for more. We're doing another round."
The rest of us slammed our cans as he took off into the house. Suddenly, the Taka girls, who clearly had just watched us shotgun our beers, were huddled around the eight of us.
"Open up, boys."
These booze sirens had some sort of inexplicable control over us, so we all tilted our heads back and waited to be served.
Marijuana.
What? The girl who approached me was a tall blonde wearing a low-cut halter top, and when she smiled, I had no choice but to make a run at her. "I'm Towns. What's your name?" "My name is I'm dating a senior in Alpha." I tilted my head back and opened my mouth immediately. She poured until I couldn't swallow anymore and then kept pouring until I spit up vodka all over Penny's back.
"What the fuck?" Penny turned around, confused.
The alleged girlfriend laughed as she turned to walk back inside. I couldn't tell if she was fucking with me or the active she was dating had sent her out as bait, knowing one of us would hit on her and be subject to pledge punishment.
You know what? Now that I'm thinking about it, I'm like 90% sure that was inspired by one of my pledge brothers fucking or no, you know what it was? You know, it was that he hit on an active's girlfriend at our first like rush party like this, and it became this big thing that we got like our balls hazed off for. It was very unfortunate. Could have happened to anybody, in fairness. It just happened to happen to a dude who was like in my wedding and is one of my dear friends, and it was hysterical. So that's what that came from.
Look at that, look behind the author fucking thing. Behind the author. Click here and I'll tell you the behind the author about this next page. Don't. There's no button.
Yep. The alleged girlfriend laughed as she turned and walked back inside. I couldn't tell if she was fucking with me or the active she was dating had sent her out as bait, knowing one of us would hit on her and be subject to pledge punishment. The last vodka shot took me from shit-faced to out of control. I need to be put to bed drunk. As I felt my mouth over-salivating, Monty reemerged with another shirt full of beers.
"All right, let's go again," he said.
"Damn it, Monty, you just avoided the Taka girls, you prick," Nate scolded him. "Actually, they got me on my way out, so stop bitching and do another shotgun." That put Monty in his place, and he grabbed for Penny's knife. Tim gave the toast this time. I didn't really hear what he was saying because I was too busy trying to mentally ready my stomach for another full beer, but it was something about America and the bald eagle and how Kennedy was right about the Russians. Then he counted to three and we pounded our beers. I finished a little over half before dropping the can and rushing to the edge of the balcony. Pink vomit launched from my stomach through my mouth. The guys were all very amused.
"You all right, you fucking lightweight?" Tim asked as he kicked me in the ass while I was still leaning over the edge. "I'm fine. It's got an air bubble."
And I checked my phone as I wiped my mouth. It was nearly 1 a.m. and I had three texts from Allison. So I'm just going to hold it up because it's like, the first one says, "Where are you? Katie is looking for you near the speakers." The second one says, "Quit being an asshole." And the third one says, but they're like, this is the. I don't know if you can see that, but the point is she's fucking wasted and the text don't read properly as a result. 69 viewers. Ha ha. Nice. Inappropriate. Inappropriately appropriate. I stumbled back inside and grabbed a beer out of the first tub I saw to freshen my breath. The party was still in full swing, and all the guys split up to try and spend our final night of freedom with a female companion. I headed toward the dance floor and found Amy making out. Oh, making one of the. Damn, that was scary. We almost thought Amy, our girl, was gone, dude. I was like, fuck, Towns. You should have been inside instead of shotgunning beers and puking, you stupid fool. But no, false alarm. I was scared. You were scared. Bruce wasn't scared. He bailed. Bella was scared. She's still over there. You can't see her. Thank fucking God, man. The one chance at romance we might have in this book. Almost shot to shit. Amy was making one of the 4-foot-tall speakers her dance partner, while Allison and her other sisters watched, laughed, and filmed her with their iPhones. Towns! Amy screamed immediately and jumped on me. Where have you been? I was outside with the guys, I said, trying not to breathe my throw-up breath on her. You doing okay?
I'm fine.
She was using about 6 extra vowels for each word.
Here,
she handed me her cup of punch. I don't want this. And she definitely doesn't need it, added Allison. Get her out of here. She lives on the 8th floor of Manor. Don't you live in Manor? Oh, damn it. I'm sorry, guys. I'm sorry. Hold on.
And she definitely doesn't need it, added Allison. Get her out of here.
Weed cough.
She lives on the 8th floor of Manor. Don't you live in Manor?
She winked at me again, and it made my dick twitch every time. He loves that deep voice. That shit gets him fucking going. That shit gets him going. As weird as it was to have a girl that I had recently been inside of and totally would have fucked to completion had it not been for an ill-timed cannon explosion now hooking me up with a younger sister of hers, there was no way I was passing it up. Let's get you home, I told Amy. Amy wrapped her arm around in mine, and Allison slapped me on the ass as we walked away. I wish she had another line. But she didn't. This book would have been a lot better if at the beginning it was like, by the way, Allison just has like an incredibly deep, mannish voice. Can we alter that? I'm going to holler at the publisher and see if I can get that a line added in to the next edition that they print or whatever. All right. Old fucking Amy here is going to catch the D, I think. Let's see. We were passing through the asshole of the house when Amy caught her sandal on the doorstep and fell forward face first into the deck. I pulled her to her feet while she giggled. There was no way this girl was going to successfully walk all the way back to our dorm. Please don't fuck this girl. Where are you two lovebirds going? Monty asked as he walked out behind us. I'm trying to get Amy here back safely to Manor, but she can't walk and I definitely can't fucking drive. Fuck it. I need to get home and call Sarah anyway, said Monty. I'll drive y'all. I tossed him my keys before he could change his mind, then threw Amy over my shoulder and headed back to my truck. What are you, a caveman? Monty drove 20 miles per hour the entire way home like an elderly woman with cataracts, but we made it. When we got to the house, or to the elevator, I pressed 8, and Amy spoke for the first time since we left the house.
No, 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 no. I don't want to go to bed yet. Can I hang out with you?
With me? I said, surprised. Sure you can.
Damn it, Downs.
I hadn't pegged her for the type, and definitely didn't think she'd be awake much longer, but this was a definite hookup move by her. Monty was making blowjob hand gestures behind her.
Absolutely, Amy.
Oh, wait, this is a dude. Absolutely, Amy, he said. You're more than welcome to hang in our room. When we hit our floor, Monty dialed Sarah's number. I'll talk to Sarah in the hall, he said behind Amy's back. I'll give you an hour. Tell her I love her, I said sarcastically. I love you too, Amy chimed in. I wasn't sure if she was talking to me, so I just ignored the misunderstanding. When I unlocked the door and hit the lights, Amy pushed past me, giggling, and flopped down on my bed.
Come here, she said sweetly.
I turned the light off and made my approach. We made out for a few minutes, and then I remembered that I'd thrown up less than an hour ago and pulled away.
What's wrong? She asked.
Nothing, nothing, sorry.
Am I not good?
Good at making out? I was just thinking about how ridiculous that party was.
I can make you think about something else. Lay down under the covers and take off your shorts.
I ripped away the covers and pulled my shorts off like they were on fire. She climbed on top of me fully clothed and pulled the covers over us.
Try thinking about this.
She peeled off. Why is this chick getting sultry voice now? She pulled off her shirt to reveal a pink-laced bra and then pulled my boxers down to my ankles. This is very, very explicit. If you're a child, now is the time to leave. If you're a child, now is the time to leave. You have 10 more seconds. These people are going to make adult things happen. You shouldn't be here. You're a child. It is, Lumpy. I'm permanently on. I'm always on 18+, bro. But these kids lie. and they log into their older brother's accounts. Look, if you're under 15, at least leave. Yeah, you're out. You're out. You're out. You're out. Get the. You're out. You're out. Ear porn. You know there's an audiobook for this read by some random dickhead? It's not even me. They didn't just fucking copy-paste my audio from this and put that fucking shit in there. And include this part where I'm just fucking talking into the abyss? Fuck. What? Who? Oh, no. Okay, this is getting very explicit. I'm serious. If you're a child, get the fuck out. Get the fuck out, kid, you fuck. 30 seconds of sucking later, and I was still soft as a... What the hell happened? Did I miss a page? Oh, yeah, she pulled down his pants. 30 seconds of sucking later, and I was still as soft as a wet, uncooked hot dog. This couldn't even be classified as whiskey dick. More like, in order for your vital organs to function, we have to shut down everything else, dick. I closed my eyes and desperately tried to imagine Victoria's Secret model's tits bouncing down the runway, but instead I got the spins. Amy must have been too drunk to notice because she went right on working on my windsock like a champ. The only sound in the room was the squelch, squelch, squelch of her fruitless efforts. That is the most disgusting thing I have to have ever written. It has to be. I wrote squelch, squelch, squelch in italics. Holy shit. I told the kids to leave, man. I told y'all to get the kids out. I told y'all. And I think I threw the trigger warning on the wrong chapter. That was from chapter one. We're fine. What the fuck? I think this ends with like a... I don't know. We're about to be there. We'll find out. Why am I trying to fucking throw out the ending like an idiot? What? I decided there was no reason for both of us to go unsatisfied and flipped her around on her back. Look at this cat. Being a gentleman. As I was kissing down her stomach, I looked up into her eyes and we both knew where I was going. Do it, she said as she raised her hips slightly. Do me with your tongue. I'm sorry. I dove in and used my tongue as a weapon in the sword fight against her vagina. She immediately let out a moan and wrapped her legs around my head, squirming and gripping my hair with both hands like she was controlling me with dual joysticks. Yes, 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 she whispered. Right there. Don't stop. I was licking like a lizard that hasn't had a drink in months and just discovered a pool of delicious water. I need to write porn. Like, my porn would be so funny, dude. I need to write an erotic novel. Like, that's what I'm doing next. That's exactly what I'm doing next. I just figured out what book I'm writing next. I'm writing an erotic novel. I'm not joking. This isn't a joke. I'm announcing it right now. As of now, so let's say probably 2 years from now, it'll be on shelves. I'm serious. Clip it. Clip it. Not a joke. I'm going to write an erotic comedy novel, and it will be on shelves in 2 years. Clip it. Also, I need Adderall from one of y'all to make that happen. Like, lots and lots and lots of Adderall. I'm just kidding. I can't even take Adderall. It gives me horrible panic attacks. It's very unfortunate. I can't do cocaine either anymore. Pay the price, man. You do too much of it when your brain's in puberty. Can't do amphetamines anymore, man. My heart will literally explode. Ah, Degar, which part did you miss? I'll read it again. I'm serious, I will. Okay. You know what? Fuck it. Here we go. Degar, here you go. There's a hookup starting here, okay? There's a hookup starting here. I've abandoned my child! I've abandoned my child! I've abandoned my boy! Excuse me. I have what's called... there will be blood Tourette's. It's like Tourette's, but you only yell out, there will be blood, quotes. Yeah. Okay. There's a hookup starting. I dove in and used my tongue as a weapon in the sword fight against her vagina. She immediately let out a moan and wrapped her legs around my head, squirming and gripping my hair with dual hands like she was controlling me with a joystick. Dual joysticks.
Yes, 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 she whispered. Right there. Don't stop.
I was licking like a lizard that hasn't had a drink in months and just discovered a pool of delicious water. Every 30 seconds or so, I tried to change my approach and work in some finger action. Finally, she let out a long, satisfied sigh and pulled me up by my hair to kiss me. I crammed myself up against... If you're a female right now, how'd that do for you? How'd that do for you? I'm just curious. Because, look, if we're going to do the erotic comedy book, it's got to work for chicks, too, or this is a fucking waste of my time. It's so hard to keep a straight face with some of the things that I say, like, on a day-to-day basis now, but I'm getting really good at it. Like, I'm getting really good at it. So it's getting harder and harder to tell when I'm kidding, which is pretty much my life goal at this point, for nobody to ever know anymore. Working in some finger action. Good, good, good stuff, good stuff. Okay, she lets out a long, satisfied sigh and pulls him up by his hair to kiss him. I crammed myself up against the wall next to her tiny bed, and she rested one arm on my chest and closed her eyes. Wait, what? Oh, they're in the bed. I'm tired, she yawned. I'm sleeping here. I thought that was a given, I said. Good night, Amy. Night, night, Towns. See, Towns is not a dickhead after all. After all, every single one of you doubted. Everybody thought Towns was going to do the wrong thing. Let's go to sleep. Goes down her, lets her go to sleep. I closed my eyes and felt, and it sounds like he got her, you know? Like he got her there. Huge. Huge act for him. First sexual hookup in the book. Orgasm achieved. Just eating that pussy, baby. I closed my eyes and fell asleep almost immediately. Fucking liar. No way. Well, I guess, was he whiskey dicked up? Wasn't he? Yeah, no, he was. Never mind, he went to sleep. I closed my eyes and fell asleep almost immediately. The next morning, I woke up on my back with my boxers still around my ankles and, ironically, a raging case of morning wood. Amy was gone, and Monty was still asleep in his bed.
Monty!
I yelled to wake him. He rolled over and barely opened his eyes.
Jesus, what?
Were you awake for that? I asked. Was I awake for what? I passed the fuck out on a couch in the hallway, and when I came in, it was 4 a.m. You guys were out cold. You better have fucked her. Dude, I wish. Way too much punch. I ended up tongue deep for like 30 minutes. It happens. Now leave me alone. We've got one more hour to sleep before we have to go to house cleanup. Just thinking about how Mr. Weston was waiting for us at the absolutely trashed house made it impossible to fall back asleep. So I took a bottle of water from the fridge and grabbed my laptop. As I looked through Facebook pictures of the guys and I covered in paint at the Alpha House, it suddenly became real that Rush was over. I scrolled over and clicked deactivate your account, like Mr. Weston had demanded, and then closed my laptop and tried to ready myself to face pledship head on. Tongue Deep. That is a novel title. 30 minutes tongue deep, baby. I know it's beat.
Remix.
Now it's the little ellipsis fucking little explanation thingy, whatever. I don't even know. Fuck. I don't even know. They made me do this, all right? They made me fucking do this. Midnight is one of the most celebrated nights in Greek culture. For the actives, it's the end of having to convince a bunch of younger guys that... Oh, we were trying to put like a cap on each little... Midnight is one of the most celebrated nights in Greek culture. For the actives, it's the end of having to convince a bunch of... Okay, that's it. Appreciate y'all. Thanks for coming to tonight's reading. No, I'll get the book. That was unfortunate. Son of a bitch! There's like 3 of these in existence, man.
I'm so tempted to light this on fire right now. There's a candle right there. There's a candle right there. Get off my ass, y'all. Fuck. Shit. One of the most celebrated nights in Greek culture. For the actives, it's the end of having to convince a bunch of the younger guys that joining the fraternity is the best decision they'll ever make. For the Rushies, it's the beginning of a whole new life in the fraternity with a whole new group of best friends in their pledge class. It's also their last chance to get as blackout drunk as they can before the rough stuff starts. And now here are the TFMs for this chapter. You know how there's like the little individual ones or whatever? You know, you got, you're good, you're smart. You were smart, you were kind. On bid night, getting fucked up and fucking shit up. Give that guy two bids, because he'll probably lose one tonight. TFM. I guess this can be my bookmark now. This page I tore out of this sacred text. Losing a pledge on bid night. Like actually losing him. Seriously, he's still missing. TFM. Alcohol is only a depressant if your life sucks. TFM. This is not even... God damn it. It's so fucking weird that I don't drink now. Drinking away problems you don't have. TFM. What I do when I'm blacked out is none of my damn business. TFM. Getting light the wrong end of your cigarette drunk. TFM. So many times. So many times. The no alcohol beyond this point sign might as well say, I bet you can't chug that whole drink, TFM. The door that got kicked in last night was a beer pong table this afternoon, TFM. Proving the beer before liquor, never been sicker phrase is complete horseshit on a daily basis, TFM. There's a fine line between confident and cocky, and I just snorted it, TFM. That's one of my all-time favorite ones, man. The fine line between I think I wrote that one. I think that's why it was like one of my particular favorites, because I used to sit there and write those fucking things back in the day at the beginning of the website when there weren't that many submissions. So that was the chapter. Here are the pictures for the chapter. Flipping tables. Well, you're over here. Damn it. Flipping tables for fun, TFM, and the correct way to use a pool, TFM. This one says, I'm not picking this shit up, call the pledges. This one says, that door was old anyway, TFM. And that's it. So next Sunday, right here, same place, twitch.tv/bossrollin, we will do chapter 5, The Hazement, which I think is about hazing, if I had to guess. And the hazing and the sexual, 69 viewers, nice. The hazing and the sex chapters are the best. Because for whatever reason, I write really funny sex. I do not know why. It is so fucking funny. It's like because it's graphic and descriptive, but they're wasted. So I guess, I don't know. I'm going to have to figure out this whole angle on my erotic comedy novel. But it's coming in 2023. Book it. The squelching, man. That was really tough. That was really tough shit. So, all right, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to take about, what fucking time is it? 10 o'clock. I'm going to take about a 15-minute break here and go poo-poo, maybe make a phone call. And then I'm going to be right back on right here, same place, twitch.tv/bossrollin, to play some Warzone to unwind before bed. Again, here's what I want you to do. We raised $3,000 over the weekend. Donate to one of these two places. If you're from Houston like me or you're Texas people and you want to look for a place to put money in Texas, positivepurposes.org. It's chaired by Mr. Brad Scarface Jordan. very, very legendary rapper, also activist, recently ran for city council in Houston. An incredible dude that has given me way more time than I would have ever guessed to have gotten from Scarface, and he's their chairman. So what I'm saying is, I promise you this money will go to good shit. It's going to help people who need it to break a piece of the very big fucked up puzzle that is our system in America currently. And the other place was in Minnesota, the Black Visions Collective Minnesota, which you can find at blackvisionsmn.org. If you have the means to help and give to organizations, find organizations that you believe in. Look up the people in charge of them, okay? Look into what they're actually doing with their money. Talk to the people in charge if you have that opportunity. And put money in places that's going to help fix the things that we all know are contributing to the massive issues that have now boiled over into our streets. And beyond that, you can obviously get active in other ways, but if you have the means to give and you have extra money, which a fuckload of white people do, and I know y'all, put it somewhere that matters. Some of it. You don't need all of it. Put it somewhere that can help some people who didn't have the opportunities you had. That's one way to start making this better from our end. So we did $3,000 this weekend. We'll do more this week. And we're going to be figuring out other ways to do shit like this year round for the time.